For the Lord himself will descend from the heavens with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive will be caught up in the skies with the Lord, and there shall we be with the Lord forever. This is the hope of the church.
My name is Faith Noble Adra. Do you want to understand the realities of these end times? Dr. Linus Pauling, a winner of Nobel Peace Prizes in 1954 and 1963, said he believes, and I quote, "The greatest catastrophe in the world is approaching," unquote. What about you? Join me on the rapture.
I welcome you to this morning's edition of the rapture. We will continue looking at the events at the judgment seat of Christ, which is also known as the Bema, which is specifically designed for the church, those who will be saved at the rapture. Hallelujah. But before we proceed, I just want to draw your attention to the developments across the world that features in, you know, we deal with some Bible prophecy, though on a limited basis now, but just to be giving you an idea about many of the things that are foretold. We cannot ignore all the warnings that has been the hallmark of many of the books in the Bible. About 18 of the books in the Bible have been devoted mainly to prophecy, foretelling of future events. And I've been drawing your attention to the key players in these last days of China, the West, specifically the EU and the US, their role in these last days. And the Middle is the hot spot of end time prophecy. Hallelujah. And the beginning of this year, China announced it is increasing its budget on military and defense by 91.5. That was just last week it was announced, $91.5 billion. And it's sending a lot of fears. Many analysts say China's actual spending on defense is far higher than the government's reports. And China has been building up its military in recent years. And I remember even yesterday, the U.S. Senator John McCain was asking the Australians to collaborate with the United States as Asia is coming under the sole tutelage of a nation like China with its military might. And I explained to you that China, together with India, they are known as the kings of the East, and they have a special role on the great battle of Armageddon that we popularly hear about. China, the military might and all that is going on, it's not for fun. They know that there's going to be a great bloodbath at the end of this age. The only gap that is separating the world from, or the militaries of the world from that issue, is the rapture. The day the church leaves this world, hell is going to break loose, and we cannot underrate those facts. So all these developments, for instance, Russia, I told you that Russia, together with the Islamic allies in the Middle East, will be invading Israel, according to a prophecy in Ezekiel 38 39. And the beginning of this year, Russia also announced that it will spend more than one-fifth of its overall budget on military security and defense. This reminds me of one of the things that one of the former presidents of the United States, Dwight Eisenhower, he said, every gun that is made and every warship that is launched, every rocket that is fired, in the final sense, a theft from those who hunger and are not fed. The World Health Organization estimates that one-third of the world's population is not fed, one-third is underfed, one-third is well-fed, but the nations keep pumping their money into the military. The answer is simple. There's going to be a convergence on the plains of Megiddo, and these are all warnings to the church. Church, our presence here is the only thing that is restraining evil from taking possession of the planet. Hallelujah. So we cannot ignore all these warnings. We have to be alive and kicking. This is the time we should sit up and watch. I know many of you will not watch many of these things. It will not make much sense to you. But even you can look into your personal life. The question still goes, where is the planet heading to? We cannot afford to be sleeping. This is not the time to be craving for everything in this world. This is the time to make sure that you are fully prepared if the trumpet should go today. Let me draw your attention. Look at what is happening in the Middle East right now. You know, Libya will be a strong force to reckon with when we look at the events through the prophetic glass, talking about many of the prophecies in the Bible. You remember when I was speaking to you about the allies of the invasion, I spoke to you about the Gog and the Magog invasion in Ezekiel 38. And it mentions a bunch of nations that will be invading Israel in the latter times. Now, talking about Russia,
Persia, Libya, and Ethiopia. Libya has been specifically mentioned in the Bible as one of the invaders. You can check that in Ezekiel 38:5. And so, Libya, whatever is happening in Libya right now, is going to create a very strong hatred, because you can see the West and the United States pouncing on Libya in these times. And it's just making the regime so difficult. Whichever government comes to power after the events have died down will still be a viable ground for the coming invasion. Why? Because look at it. Like, you know, Gaddafi is accusing Al-Qaeda of being behind it. Al-Qaeda is another group that is opposed to Israel and to the West. So if even hardline Islamists should come to power, the value will still be the same, that the hatred towards the West and to Israel will be great. Now, when you study international politics carefully, all that is happening now, you realize that Russia is very silent. And China, they are the backdrops in any attempt to impose a military or whatever sanction on Libya. And if the Bible tells us that Russia and their allies, together with Libya, Persia, and whatever, Ethiopia, will be invading Israel, the conditions are just getting right. Let me tell you, the regime changes that are going around the Middle East is very, very important, very, very crucial. So there's going to be a contention for power in the Middle East, in the sense that whoever controls the Middle East, the Persian Gulf, the control of that area is necessary for economic sustenance. Because if hardliners come to power, you can be sure that they will block oil supply to the West. And many of the Western countries, their economies are really based on the oil from the Persian Gulf. So if the Bible tells us that there's going to be even a 10-nation confederation from the West, the regime of the Antichrist that will be contending for power in the Middle East, we shouldn't doubt many of these things. The developments are just preparing the way. The world is looking for a Messiah. They are calling on Brussels and Washington as the Messiah as of now. And that is sending signals that power consolidation in the West is necessary to lobby, because there's going to be a counter move from Russia and the kings of the East. Are you getting it? These are great things. If we want to talk about Bible prophecy, these are great, really great things. And we cannot ignore all these things. We live in the world that is on a collision course, destined for destruction, the wrath of God. Nuclear Holocaust, everything you see in the book of Revelation is pointing to the nuclear Holocaust that is ahead of the world. What are you doing as a church? What are you doing as a believer? Hallelujah. Jesus said, watch, watch. Hallelujah. So let's continue with the judgments in the prayer. That's just by the way. I believe we'll come to times that we will do a thorough study on the subjects. But as I've been updating you, just be watching. You watch, you pray. Hallelujah. I've been speaking to you about the crown of life that is for those who overcome temptations. In James chapter 1 verse 12, Bible says, blessed is the man who persevere under temptation, because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. Hallelujah. So overcoming temptation is one of the simplest demonstration of your love for God. The Bible says those who overcome temptation, God has the crown of life for them. And I spoke about those things. I touched on a few things. And I know that that is the graveyard where many believers are buried, awaiting their evacuation to hell. Temptations. And we have coined all sorts of theologies to back it. Yeah. I never want to talk about this again, but the Holy Spirit will not permit that. He said that is the graveyard. Warn them. Tell them, if they fail to listen, you have discharged your duty. Look at what the Bible says. It said, no temptation has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. The Bible is telling us in 1 Corinthians 10:13 that no temptation that comes the way of any man upon the face of the earth, especially believers, is beyond their reach. Bible says God will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. The logic here from what the Bible is saying is that no amount of temptation justifies sin. God is not going to connive with any sin and does it with a green light, saying, oh, this temptation there is beyond you. Bible says God will not permit that. So every temptation that you have succumbed to, or I have succumbed to, the failure should be placed basically at your doorstep and at my doorstep. Are you getting it? Don't follow the fables that, oh, God understands. The devil does not force you beyond a certain measure that you cannot withstand. The devil may persuade you, he may suggest to you, he may entice you with many of the flashy things that are in our world today. But he cannot force you. That is why responsibility. The earlier you stop blaming the devil and assume responsibility for all the failures when it comes to temptations, the better for you and I. Because it is only when you acknowledge that you put measures in place to overcome. Bible says the crown of life. You know, I may sound very tough to you, but you see, I see some fire blazing in all eternity. In the other side of eternity, there are many people in hell right now who have now understood that, overcoming temptations as a Christian was the simplest thing we could have done. The inhabitants of the earth don't want to buy into this one. Men are not serious when we are telling them the good news of the gospel and the power inherent to live good lives for Christ until they are 1 minute away from eternity. Today, look at all over the place. Now, when people are dying, we are even lucky that they are even voicing certain things before they journey. Hallelujah. Where they have chosen for themselves. Temptation abounds in our world. But Bible says, he who overcomes. And I warned you last week about emulating, trying to copy, using preachers who are doing godless things as role models. Stop it. It is not biblical. The preachers have become the God of many believers. And having looked at how many of them have failed, many people have resolved that, even if my pastor is doing that, if that pastor is doing that, that pastor. A soul, I told you, is a soul. The soul that is in the pastor is the same soul that is in the member. You don't go to hell because your pastor is not doing well. Look at what Jesus actually said concerning ungodly, unchrist-like leadership and how the people of God should beware of it. I'm saying this thing, and you better take it. I have told you this day. Are you getting it? When you go to Matthew chapter 23, verse 13, Jesus said, "Woe to you, teachers of the law," and the Pharisees. Who are the teachers of the law? They were the pastors, the apostles, the bishops of the days of Jesus. Look at what Jesus was telling them. "Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You shut the kingdom of heaven in the face of men. You yourself do not enter. You will not let those who are trying to enter to enter." This is what Jesus said. Jesus said, the religious leaders of his day shut the kingdom of heaven. They cross it in the face of men by their attitude. Not that they will not stop living in their hypocrisy, but on another hand, they force the people to agree that, it is normal. Temptation, it abounds. God understands the 21st century is complex. Jesus said, what they are doing is this. They shut the kingdom of heaven. They will not go in themselves. They know they have traded their integrity. They are in no position to enter that glorious city, which the Bible tells us that no field is entering. Jesus told the people to beware of this kind of people. I tell you, there are godly people, leaders in the world. Why don't you learn from them? Why do you keep singing the songs of failure? So some of you hear these things, you take a deep breath and say, I'm not alone in the failure. We are all in sin. We are all, nobody can be righteous. Beloved, as for the road, is getting narrow every day. These last days, is getting narrow. The door is getting narrow. The road to hell is very, very congested. The theologies and the opinions that are coming in these last days are dangerous, and they are going to evacuate masses. But this thing is sure, that God has not left anybody without a warning or evidence, and you have to take it. I spoke to you about other areas of temptation, like the dressing code we are witnessing today. Let me tell you, I know a lot of people say holiness comes from the heart. Have you heard that thing before? Yeah, that is perfectly true. Are you getting it? Holiness comes from where? The heart. But no one who is truly holy in the inside can be smelling hell or breathing hell in the outside. Do you get that? It is true that there are people who can pretend to be holy on the outside, but in the inside, they are rotten. But there cannot be anybody who is holy in the inside and everything about him or her is winning souls for hell. It is a big lie. So you see a lot of people who are naked in church, they tell you, we are holy. We are holy. Holiness comes from the heart. And your attire is winning souls for hell. No, don't live in that deception. Are you getting what I'm saying? You take it. This is the opinion of God. That day you cross to eternity, you are going to live alone. You are not going to go with those who have taught you those theologies. You are going to go alone and take it. This is the opinion of God. And I spoke to you about profane conversations. That forms another axis of temptation. Profane. Today, profanity is the order of the day. The Bible tells us, or Paul was admonishing Timothy as a pastor. Timothy was a pastor, but look at what Paul was telling him. He said, but refuse profane and old wife fables. Profane and old wives fables. Christians are doing it. The devil has made all the means available today. And this thing is full in the churches. I can't be teaching you how to make money because you need to know where you are going first. If you are saved in eternity, what is it if you don't get all the stars in this world? Hallelujah. Get it. Let nobody deceive you. Jesus said the door will be like the days of Noah. What are you thinking? Some of you think God will lower his standard.
Okay. Hallelujah. Are you getting it? Temptation. Blessed is the man who overcomes temptation. It abounds everywhere. So the effect is very simple. There are a lot of people who have loaded a lot of profane things in their mind. There are many believers. Even in their prayer room, they want to pray 5 minutes. All their minds are hovering over all the profane things. That is how they have fed their mind. Bible says, flee from all these things. You expose yourself to them, your mind becomes corrupted with the virus of sin. Let me tell you, when you become born again, your mind is not born again. How many of you agree with that? If you are a believer, you become born again, your mind is not born again on that day. The mind takes constant feeding on the word of God to become born again. How do I know that? You remember Paul was speaking to the Romans. He said, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. These were born again believers. Paul is telling them that they should be transformed by the renewing of the mind. You know, man is made up of body, soul, and spirit. Man is a spirit. When you become born again, it is your spirit that becomes born again. But your soul, which is part of your intellect, your mind, and all those things, they are not born again. They will connive with, your mind will connive with your body to be dragging you back to temptation, to sin again. But Bible says the only thing that can transform the mind and make it subject to the spirit life that you have become subscribed to is the word. Are you getting it? So feed yourself, feed your mind on the word of God. Don't feed your mind with all the viruses that are going on. Hallelujah. You may say it is difficult. It is difficult. But compare it to the consequences that lies all eternity. And get it. Hallelujah. Virus is the spirit of man, is the candle of the Lord. God deals with your spirit. If you allow your mind to control your body, if you allow, you train your mind to receive any signal, temptation signal. Yeah, it's very common. Many of you cannot concentrate. You can make every calculation. Once you see something with your eye, you can calculate what the next one will be like, what the other one will be like. And these are all because you have trained your mind. You have broken down your spiritual defense system that you cannot resist anymore. Temptation is leading masses. I'm going to show you from scripture. Now, I want to quickly move to another area of temptation. You know, Jesus Christ was tempted, and one of the things that the devil offered Jesus Christ was wealth and the riches of this world. I'm taking you again to Matthew chapter 4, verse 8 to 9. Bible says, again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor, their glory, their beauty, their riches. And he said to Jesus that all these things I will give unto you if you bow down and worship me. So one of the temptations that Jesus had was wealth of the kingdoms of this world. And riches is another area that masses have been trapped in Christendom. And the truth is that if you don't overcome it, God will not save you. He'll send you to where those who covet, those who trust in riches belong. I know it may not sound comfortable to you, but that is the truth. Are you getting it? The devil tempted Jesus, offering him the kingdoms, the world of this world, as he's offering many believers today. Let me tell you, many of the things you are craving for, when you get to eternity, you realize that they really don't matter. They are not necessary. They are bogus thinking things. Get it? Jesus knew, it was written about him, that the kingdom will be on his way, on his shoulder. The government, the kingdom that the devil is offering him, Jesus came purposely to carry the cross ahead of that kingdom. The government will soon be on his shoulder. Hallelujah. When he comes the second time. But the devil tempted Jesus by offering to him what God has already promised him at the wrong time. Are you getting it? So Satan has offered wealth to many people and we call it blessings. That is not to say wealth is wrong. The problem is that Bible says those who put their trust in it. We have taught people how to make wealth, but we have not taught them how to handle the huge temptation that is associated with wealth. Craving for riches. The devil offered Jesus the same way the devil is offering. There are many things. God has promised to bless you and to make you the richest person on earth. But you know, God knows how to go about it. The devil can come ahead and offer you the same thing you think that is what God said.
like the way he did to Jesus. If Jesus accepted the kingdoms of this world, currently they are under the control of the devil. He said, I'll give it to you. But Jesus knew that before the kingdom come upon his shoulder, he must go to the cross. Many of you are not willing to go to the cross, but you just want to embrace everything. But Jesus overcame the devil. The Bible says angels attended to him. The devil is trapping many of us in church today with riches. Everybody wants to get rich in this world. Let me tell you, it is not possible. You can look at past, present, and you can forecast the future that it is not possible that all of you in the church will be rich. But there's one thing that all of you in the church need. You need to overcome so that when the Son of God appears, there's a greater world up there. Some people say, oh, we don't believe in that thing, that it's only that heaven that we can get all these things. Let me tell you, some of you, the only way God can save some of you, excuse me, who have great wealth, is by taking what you have from you. Many of you will not agree with me on that. But let me ask you, do you agree with me that there are many rich people who were trapped by riches to hell? Yeah, that is very, very true. So if God had helped them by taking the riches from them, wouldn't it have been better? I'm not saying riches are bad, but I'm going to show you. Bible says you should not put your trust. You should not put your what? Your trust. Bible says command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant, not put their trust or hope in wealth. 1 Timothy 6:17 to 19. Command those who are rich. It is part of my responsibility as a preacher to command those who are rich in this present world not to put their hope. Many people are not handling the temptation that is associated with wealth. A rich young man came to Jesus one day in St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 19, verse 16 to 24. The Bible says, now came up to Jesus and asked, teacher, what good thing must I do to get eternal life? Why do you ask me about what is good? Jesus replied, there is only one who is good. If you want to enter life, obey the commandments. Which ones? The man inquired. Jesus replied, do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, do not give false testimony, honor your father and mother, and love your neighbors as yourself. The gentleman replied, all this I have kept. What do I still lack? Jesus answered, if you want to be perfect, go sell your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have a treasure in heaven. When the young man heard this, he went away sad because he had great wealth. We have taught them how to be rich, but we have not taught them how to share their riches. Yeah, the rich man we read about in St. Luke's Gospel 16 was in hell because he has not learned the rules of the riches God gave him. It is then we begin. Command those who are rich not to put their hope in their riches. And let them, teach them to share with others. He was in hell because he has not learned the rules regarding how to handle, maintain wealth. And this is one of the areas of temptation in this world. The fake and the crooked means of acquiring riches are now being taught on the pulpit with preachers specializing in it, so that by the time the ordinary man comes out of church, he is burning with passion to get the whole world in the next moment. I was shocked. I've never heard Jesus say anything good about rich folks before. I'm shocked. And the only thing he asked is how to caution them, how to advise them to handle so that it doesn't destroy them. Riches come with great responsibility. And I must tell you, you see, I know many people will not tell you this thing. As I'm telling you now, some of you will be screaming, you think I'm against you, but that is not the case. The one who loves you is the one who will correct you, who will tell you what will save you. Just accept it. Are you getting it? I can collect your money, I can do this thing. And you know, the people who help you are the people you are likely to deceive the most. You know, when somebody is helping you, giving you a lot of money, to correct that person is difficult. So you can correct other people, they will be saved. But that person, you not correct him. You give him a fancy face. And that is what is happening in church today. How many preachers are bold enough to call those who have great wealth to others so that they might save their soul? It is difficult. So rich folks, get it. The people who love you are the people who tell you the truth. And only those who are led by the Spirit of God can have the boldness and courage to address these issues. Let us relax. Let us all make sure that we have a firm grip over the kingdom first. Then every other thing can be given to you, and it will not pose you a problem. We have gone for wealth, but we have not gotten the kingdom, and we are happy. It is not true. Let me tell you, command those who are rich not to put their hope. It is very easy to come and put your trust in riches without knowing. It is very easy to put your trust all your trust. That day when you get to the presence of God, he measure your trust level. 99% for riches, 1% for God. And you're going to be shocked. So if God had warned you earlier, wouldn't it have been better? Let me tell you, according to my Bible, riches, temptation of wealth and riches trap 1/4 of all those in Christendom. Are you getting it? So it's a very important area we ought to address. Temptation associated with wealth trust 1/4 of all those in Christendom. You remember the parable of the sower? Jesus spoke about different categories of seed sown, Matthew 13 verse 1-7, and he spoke about another seed, the last of the failed seeds that was sown, were seeds that fell among thorns, which grew up. The thorns grew up and choked the plants. Are you getting it? Four categories of seeds sown. Three of them failed. One of those three is what? The ones that were sown among thorns. And Jesus Christ was explaining the meaning of the thorns in which the seeds were sown in Matthew 13:22. This is what he said. He said, the one who received the seed that fell among thorns is the man who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth. Take note of it. The deceitfulness of what? Riches, choke it, making it what? Unfruitful. There are many great people in the church who could have overcome if we had taken our stand and taught them how to handle these things that God has given to them. Many of you are saying, craving for wealth, but you have not learned how to handle it. Some of you, if God give it to you, you will never share it with anyone, and it will destroy you. How many of you believe when you become richer, you share it with people? Just look at yourself right now, what you have. How many people do you share it with? The rich man was in hell for not sharing with Lazarus. He ignored him. He said, I work for it. That's what they said. That's what they say. And we have not been able to correct them. How many people will you share with when God takes you there? Beloved, this is the time of great warning. And the invitation God is sending out today is to everybody. Whether you are a preacher, you are a member, whoever. God is making a last batch of invitations for all people to come to him. Don't look at your profile. What people think about you doesn't matter. Now God is making a fresh batch of invitations. I remember during one of Billy Graham's crusades, a renowned evangelist came forward to accept Jesus Christ. And the ushers went to him and asked him, sir, we perceive you are coming to rededicate your life to Jesus. He said, I've come to give my life to Jesus. And they were shocked because he's a renowned preacher. He said, I know myself more than you know. Beloved, this time the terrain is getting hotter. And any moment God is making an invitation, don't look at those around you. Don't harden your heart. Don't sell your soul to the devil. Come over. The water of life is flowing very freely. Hallelujah. God has prepared a great city for us with rich variety of architecture and mansions for each one of us who is faithful in serving him. The city has great resources, fruits, rivers, fountains, and is adapted to all the nations of the earth. And from all the nations of the earth, people will gather from many people, tongues, countless numbers at the rapture of the church. How prepared are you? What are the things that are blocking you in the heaven? Give up everything. Leave everything. People leave their wealth, everything, just to gain one thing they want in life. People give up everything just to hold political position they want. People give up everything just to get what they want in this life. As a believer, what can't you give up just to gain this eternal life? It is not twice. It is once. Once the door is shut. You see, nowadays, people call me. They say, this person is dead. That person is dead. That person is dead. That person is dead. First, when I hear those things, it doesn't make any sense to me. But now, every time I hear these things, the souls of the people, where are they going? That becomes the commonest question. The day they are going to bury a person, they don't carry any of these things with them. But these are the things that traps the person and deprive him and put him in the horrors of the dungeons of hell for all eternity. And you don't want us to talk about this. You want to go and join them. Even the devil regretted being in hell. Beloved, I am warning you. These are times of great challenges, great temptations. Please, just be sure that you are in the Lamb's Book of Life. Every other thing is a sinking sound. Are you getting it? If you get a kingdom first, you'll not be trapped by all these things. But if you don't have the kingdom, you go after these things, you'll be trapped by them. I'm not against riches, but do not put your trust in them. The Bible says, command those who are rich not to put their trust in riches. So anytime temptation is flashing through your way, all these attractions to go a cheap, faster way, to succumb to sin and all these things. Remember that there is a crown of life awaiting those who overcome temptation. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes in these last days. God bless you for listening to this program this morning. I know I've trampled upon many of you, your theologies, but accept it that way. That is my responsibility. The rest is left with you. I also go and account. Did you tell them what we asked you to tell them? Yeah. And I have to answer, yes, I did. But what are you going to say? Are you going to say you listen to it or you brush it aside as rubbish? If you want to accept Jesus as your Lord and personal Savior, just pray this prayer with me. If you want to rededicate your life to Jesus, just pray this prayer with me. Hallelujah. Say, dear Lord Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God. I believe you died for my sins. I believe I must overcome in order to share in your glory. Empower me with the Holy Spirit, with your word, to overcome all the trials of these last days, all the temptations, so that when you appear in your glory, I can be found faithful. Amen. God bless you for accepting Jesus Christ. Make amends in your life. Until the same time, next week, do not put your trust in riches. Amen.
God bless you. For any inquiries about the message you've just heard, you can call any of the following numbers: 0243-381-684, 0279-935-868, or 0201618-282. To get copies of these and other messages by the preacher, call the same numbers. Don't forget the word of the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 16:22. If anyone does not love the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be anathema. Maranatha.